sun comes up, it's a new day dawn.
Here we are. This is what happens when you get talking. You forget the time, but that's a good thing because we've had so little time to talk over these months. It's just good to be here. A reminder before we start, there is coffee afterwards. Now, some seats have been put out because I know some folk were struggling and would find it easier to sit at a seat. So if that suits you, that's fine. Can I just remind folk, as I said on Sunday, we were aware because some folk told us that one or two people in the congregation on the Sunday had COVID and they'd tested for it after they'd been. Now, we don't think anyone caught it in church, but we just wanted to make everybody aware that although we're wearing our masks and things, it could be that there are folk around. So just as you're having tea and coffee and things, maybe just watch your space with people just in case, because we don't want anybody getting ill. But that having been said, let's enjoy each other's company and not be in fear. It's good to be here, and it's good just to know as we gather as God's people that his hand is with us. Whatever we're going through, whatever is hard, or whatever is good, as people who believe in the Lord Jesus and believe in the love of God, we look for his hand in that. I'm going to start by with a song, and it's one we know well, The Lord's My Shepherd. We're able to sing now, and so you may wish to join as we listen to the words that paraphrase that great psalm.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me. Guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will trust in you. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me.
Though I walk the darkest path,
Let's pray together. Lord, you are trustworthy. Your mercy, Lord, is what we are born into, your goodness to us that we could not earn. You fill our lives with good things, and your mercy sees us home. For even as we have rebelled and gone our own way, so you have sought us. So you have sent your own Son that we might know your truth. Died on a cross that we might be forgiven. Rose again that we might have new life in him. And so we come and we worship you, Lord, that you are the faithful one. You are always there as we call out to you. And yet, Lord, as we come, we confess that we do not always trust in you alone. Very often our lives are prayerless. Our lives are about us trying to cope and do things our own way, work things out for ourselves. And we come and we confess that sometimes, often, we turn away from you. As we come to you today, we come and we ask for your forgiveness, and we rejoice that you give it in Jesus Christ, that you restore to us the joy and peace that comes as we cast ourselves upon you, know the truth of what you have done for us. So, Lord, we pray in the words that Jesus taught us, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We've been reading God's word today, from the book of 1 Samuel, and that story that takes place after the time of the judges, but before the time of the kings. Israel's lost. They're overwhelmed by the Philistines. They aren't trusting in the Lord anymore, and we've seen how the house of Eli failed them, but how God began to give them a new leadership with young Samuel, trusting in the Lord. And in the last week we looked at the chapter where Israel said, we want a king, we want to be like all other nations, and God was disappointed, but he said to Samuel to give them a king. Well, we're going to skip forward two chapters, and those two chapters are where Samuel finds a young man, a tall young man, called Saul, and says, this will be the king. And people aren't very sure, because Saul isn't a noble, he's a donkey farmer. Nothing against donkey farmers. Maybe you know some donkey farmers and they're quite able people, but folk had their doubts about whether he might be their leader. So we're going to pick up the story in Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 11. What happens next? And this time we're going to be introduced not to the Philistines, but to another one of Israel's enemies, the Ammonites, who live to the east of Israel. Nahash, the Ammonite, the king of the Ammonites, went up and besieged Jabesh-Gilead. And all the men of Jabesh-Gilead said to him, make a treaty with us. We will be subject to you. We want to surrender. But Nahash, the Ammonite, replied, I will make a treaty with you only on the condition that I gouge out the right eye of every one of you, so to bring disgrace on Israel. The elders of Jabesh said to him, give us 7 days so that we can send messengers throughout Israel. If no one comes to rescue us, we will surrender to you. When the messengers came to Gibeah of Saul and reported the terms to the people, they all wept aloud. Just then Saul was returning from the fields behind his oxen, he's still a farmer, and asked What is wrong with everyone? Why are they weeping? And they repeated to him what the man of Jabesh had said. When Saul heard the words, the Spirit of God came powerfully upon him, and he burned with anger. He took a pair of oxen, cut them into pieces, and sent the pieces by messenger throughout Israel, proclaiming, "This is what will be done to the oxen of anyone who does not follow Saul and Samuel." Then the terror of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out together as one. When Saul mustered them at Bezek, the men of Israel numbered 300,000, and those of Judah 30,000. They told the messengers who had come, "Say to the men of Jabesh Gilead, by the time the sun is hot tomorrow, you will be rescued." When the messengers went and reported this to the men of Jabesh, they were elated. They said to the Ammonites, "Tomorrow we will surrender to you, and you can do with us whatever you like." The next day, Saul separated his men into three divisions. During the last watch of the night, they broke into the camp of the Ammonites and slaughtered them until the heat of the day. Those who survived were scattered so that no two of them were left together. The people then said to Samuel, "Who was it that said, 'Such shall Saul reign over us? Turn these men over to us so that we may put them to death.'" But Saul said, "No, no one will be put to death today. For this day the Lord has rescued Israel." Then Samuel said to the people, "Come, let us go to Gilgal and there renew the kingship." So all the people went to Gilgal and made Saul king in the presence of the Lord. They sacrificed fellowship offerings before the Lord, and Saul and all the Israelites held a great celebration. Amen. And thanks be to God for his word. I love these stories. Some of them from the book of Samuel we know well. They're stories we knew from Sunday school, stories of Hannah, or stories of Samuel in the temple, and other ones you think, have I ever read that before? Am I the only one? I read these things and think, I don't know if I remember this story before. But let's pray. Father, we ask that as we read this ancient word, that it may speak to us today about your rescue. In Jesus' name, amen. In 1942, the Japanese army attacked Singapore. The British army was in the fortress in that place. And a few days later, they surrendered to the Japanese. What was the fall of Singapore was one of the most difficult times for this country in the war. The strange thing is that the British probably didn't have to surrender. The Japanese had a big army attacking Singapore. There were 30,000 men. We can barely imagine that number of soldiers. But there were 85,000 Allied soldiers in Singapore when it surrendered. The Japanese were fairly well trained and well equipped, and some of the British soldiers were raw, but the British soldiers were in a fortification that had been built up over years to resist just this attack. And unbeknownst to them, the Japanese were just about at the end of their supply lines as the British surrendered. Churchill had sent a message to the British saying, "Do not surrender, fight to the last man." But the general in charge surrendered. Why? Because he'd lost hope. Probably because the Japanese propaganda was better than the British propaganda, and he had decided it was hopeless. And when you decide a battle is hopeless, it is hopeless. Sometimes we talk about the French surrendering at every opportunity, don't we? And we big up the British victories. But in actual fact, sometimes every country has that crisis of confidence. Sometimes people surrender too fast. I think in many ways, as a church, we have surrendered too quickly. We have sometimes run out the white flag well before the battle has been fought. We have, as a church, tended to look at the general way society is heading and said, oh, well, that's just the way things are going. There's nothing we can do about it. We better get with the times. We better change what we teach so that we fit in with what people are saying today or what they believe today. We better accommodate ourselves with it. Or worse, in terms of all the things that have changed in terms of morality of this day, we've just simply said, can you find a way that you won't do anything to us if we take a different line, please? Rather than have the confidence in saying, actually, we want to tell you what the Bible says because we believe this is good for you. We believe this is true. We believe this stands up. We have confidence in the Word of God. And in many ways, we do this all the time. We simply run up the flag before it's happened. We look at a church today and sometimes we think, you know, what can we do? As people stop coming to church, maybe if we rearrange things a bit, we might find a way to survive a bit longer. Rather than having confidence that we have got a gospel that we can proclaim to people that actually changes lives. And this is worth spending ourselves in. One of my friends recently, when faced with all the pessimism in the church, said, I'm done with this. I'm not doing decline anymore. Change of attitude. That began to say, what can we do? What can we do? What will God enable us to do? We are excited about what God might do among his people in this generation. And at a personal level as Christians, sometimes when we know what we are supposed to be doing, there's that voice within us that says, oh, you're a useless Christian. You'll not manage to do that. You'll not stand up for that. Who are you? And that voice that tells us, that we're a failure, that God will not give us the strength to do what is right, means that we give in and throw in the towel before the battle even begins. You know, one of the things that the Bible calls the devil is the father of lies. And I think one of the things that the devil is doing in this day to the church is whispering in our ear, it's over. And what we need to be able to do is say with confidence, the kingdom of God will not lose. The gospel of God has already defeated you on the cross, Satan. We are on, as we used to sing in Sunday school, I don't know if you sang it here, we're on the victory side. We're on the victory side. There is no doubt that the warfare may be long, but we know who has won, and you, devil, with your lies, are a defeated foe. Now back to this chapter. Jabesh-Gilead was a town in the north of Israel. And it was a fortified town in the north of Israel. It was a Singapore. It was a Masada. It was a secure place. And we know from the ancient texts that the Ammonites, who lived to the east, had sort of been forgotten as Israel was fighting the Philistines, who lived to the west and to the sea. But the Ammonites were a deadly foe. And already they had swamped over two tribes that were separate. They had subdued them. And one of the things they did when you subdued them is that they would maim the prisoners. And they would do that because that way you didn't kill them, but they couldn't fight anymore. They couldn't come back for round two. And so the Ammonites crossed the River Jordan and surrounded Jabesh-Gilead, expecting that the Israelites would just give in. They were so demoralized, so used to being defeated, so not trusting in God anymore, because that's what had been happening before, that it would be easy. They would be convinced that there was no point, no hope. No chance. If the Ammonites took that stronghold, it would be very dangerous. It would be a place where they could embed themselves, where they could raid and attack and dominate even more of the Israelite territory. Again, it all seemed fixed. They'd got so used to losing that it seemed that they would lose again. And here come the people in Jabesh Gilead, and immediately they are saying to the enemy, what's the terms? What do we do to keep ourselves alive? Oh, you want us to have our eye taken out? Well, you know what? I don't think we've got any choice. We'll just have to do that. At least we stay alive. Nobody will come. No help will come. And so they wait. And again, this can be the way that we are when we feel attacked. We just sometimes say, well, this is the way I am. I'm a weak Christian. I can't do anything. I'm hopeless. What's the point? Church can't do anything. I can pray, I suppose. It might help, but probably not. It didn't last time. And we just simply have this sense of having lost. And so they sue for peace, despite the horrific terms that are offered. But here's the reality. It's not what it seems. For a start, there are an awful lot of people in Israel. There are more people in Israel than there are among the Ammonites. We see that when the army eventually gets going. There's 330,000 of them. It might well be that sometimes the Bible exaggerates the numbers at this point, but the point is there. Israel can, if it puts its resources together, rally a huge big army and defeat its enemy. But it's got to believe that it can before it can. But of course, there's something even more than that, because time and time again in the Bible, Israel is told, is it not, that it isn't about even your numbers. Even if you've got tiny little numbers, the power of the Lord is among you. And if God has promised that you will win the victory, then you will win the victory. Remember, just a few years before, we had a guy called Gideon. And Gideon, in his day, it was the Moabites that were knocking everybody about, and we were given into the Moabites and all the rest of it. And the angel came to Gideon and said, "Hail, mighty warrior." And Gideon says, "Well, look at me, I'm a weed, I'm useless." He says, "No. You're a mighty warrior." Why? Not because you're a great fighter, but because the power of the living God is with you. And so Gideon goes and gets this courage that the Lord has given him, and he puts this big army together, and he's going to go and try to fight the Midianites. And what does God say to Gideon? You know the story, don't you? He says, get rid of half of it, get rid of more of it, till there's only a tiny little bit. Because I want you to know, not just that you can defeat the Midianites if you put your mind to it, that's not the point. The point is that you can defeat them with a tiny little amount, because my power is greater than any other power in the world. And in fact, this story is told again and again and again and again in the Old Testament. A little boy with 5 stones will knock down a big giant. Is that about, well, if you've got enough courage, you can beat the bully up and you can knock the... Some people teach it like that, don't they? Yeah, you can be a little David and take down the big Goliath. The point is actually you can't. By the way, don't ever tell your children, be brave like David and fight Goliath, because actually most small children go up to fight a big bully. What will happen? They'll get their face panned in, won't they? The point of the Goliath story is not be plucky like David and you can knock down a big Goliath. You can't. The point of the story is God can. That's what David taught Israel that day. If you trust in the living God, then the giant will fall. Because God's power is greater than whatever power is there. This story again and again and again. We're told, as word came, it was Saul. He might only be a donkey farmer, but the Spirit of the living God fell upon him, and he was able to say, this will not stand. God will not allow this to stand if we rally round and in his strength take this task on. You know, for us, sometimes it's simply hearing that promise of God. It says in the book of James, chapter 4, verse 7, resist the devil and he will flee from you. You know that bit where you're feeling tempted? And you're thinking, I'm just weak, and you know, the devil's telling me I'm a useless Christian, I'm not going to stand. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. And what James means by that is not say, oh, look how strong I am. It's mean you say to that devil, I belong to Jesus, and you have no authority over me. I am his, and I put myself and commit myself to him, and he will give me the power to do what is right. Get lost. You are defeated. The cross did with you. go away. Paul will say in the book of Romans, as he's looking at all the troubles that Christians face, he will say, in everything we are more than conquerors through him who gives us strength. Romans 8. Go and read it. It isn't about suddenly being plucky and being able to defeat things that are big for you. A positive mental attitude is all you need. That's not what it's about at all. It's about an attitude of faith that says, I know my Lord, and I know that he has me, and I know that I am his, and I will trust in him. One of the problems also for the people of Israel is, at this point, they're isolated. People up in this fortress in the north are trying to do their bit, people in the south trying to do that bit, and they need to realize that they stand together. And when they stand together and they stand in God's strength, when they encourage one another, when they tell the stories of what God has done, when the people that Saul's talking to begin to say, well, you've no idea what Samuel did defeating the Philistines last week, you think, gosh, God can do that. Then I've got the strength to do this. And we begin to give the word of testimony about what God has done. And it begins to bring God's people together. It's one of the reasons why it's really important that Christians gather and they talk about what Jesus has done. So you're able to say to someone who's struggling, you know, I went through something very similar, and I know how God strengthened me, and I know how he was there for me. And yeah, I got things wrong and I failed, but I know how he forgave me. And the Christian you're speaking to thinks, that God is with me too. Pray for me. And suddenly that strength that the Holy Spirit gives begins to be infectious among the people of God. One of the things we need to discover as a church is ways to share the stories of what God is doing. God is active in this congregation in D.L. St. Andrews. We may not know it because we are not telling one another of what God is doing in our lives. And so the donkey farmer leads an army and they win a victory. And at that point, people begin to see that the Spirit of God is with Saul. Now, Saul will get many things wrong, and the Spirit of God will leave him later on. There is more to this story. But at that point, he is trusting in the living God. You, says the Bible, need to do the same. You know, one of the words that comes to us today is that our society is sometimes telling people, if only you believe in yourself, you can do anything. I struggled. I went into the high school that I used to be chaplain, and they put something up, if you believe in yourself, you can accomplish anything. Here's the reality. No, you can't. Doesn't matter how much some of those children believe in themselves, they'll still fail the exam. Or they'll not get a job, or something disastrous will happen in their life. That is not the Christian message, that if only we have hope, then we will be fine. The Christian message is, there is a God who can save. And in our weakness, we rely on him. When Israel tried to do it themselves, we found that earlier, didn't we, in this story, when they took the ark out, thought, hey, we can do it. We shout the right thing, it'll be fine, like the old days. And it was a disaster. It was only when Israel began to say, what is the Spirit of God saying? And remembering that this is the same God who defeated the Egyptians and defeated the people of Jericho and was there in the past. We come with this message of the power and the strength of God. Not by your strength, not by your power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord Almighty. We need to pray in our day that we would have a sense of the power and the presence of God, that we would ask him to send his Holy Spirit upon his people again, that we would be given the confidence to know that the gospel that we have to share is powerful, that the salvation which Christ has wrought can defeat everything. I will build my church, says Jesus, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Let us trust in him. Let's pray. Father, we confess that sometimes we think we can do things in our own strength. and therefore we don't trust in you. And sometimes we're so convinced that it's hopeless that we don't trust in you. Sometimes we listen to that voice that tells us that the church is weak, that there is no power in the gospel, that nobody will believe, and so we don't trust in you. Sometimes we hear that voice in our own minds that tells us that we cannot change and be transformed and be different than we are, and so we do not trust in you. By your Holy Spirit, Lord, renew in us a vision of your gospel, a knowledge that in Jesus Christ you overcame the world. You defeated the principalities and powers. You overcame death itself, and you did it for us. And the victory that you have won, you give us a share in. The promises that you have made have been delivered in Jesus Christ and are sure and are certain. So today, as we struggle with our life with you, as we struggle as a church together, renew in us that hope in the gospel. And let us be filled with your Holy Spirit, that we may live for you in your strength. Today, Lord, we would pray particularly for Christians that we know personally that are really struggling. Some of them are struggling to believe. Some of them are struggling with difficult things that have happened in their life. Some of them are struggling because they don't feel part of things. Oh Lord, we pray for them just now. We name them just in our hearts before you. We ask that you would fill them with courage by your Holy Spirit. Today we pray for places where it's really difficult to be a Christian. We think, Lord, of the tiny little Christian churches in Afghanistan, in Pakistan. We think of the churches even in Scotland, where very often it seems nobody believes and the church isn't half open. Give us the confidence, wherever we are, that your kingdom will grow. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours forever and ever. Amen. Let's close. We've heard this song many times when we couldn't sing along with it. By faith, we see... I've forgotten the words. They're on the screen. Sing along with it if you can.
this mountain shall be moved, and the power of the gospel shall prevail.
By faith and not by sight. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, enable you to walk by faith and not by sight in this week ahead. Amen. And there's a cup of tea.